Good afternoon. Welcome to the Washington Institute. I'm Rob Satloff, the director of the Institute. I'm delighted that everyone is here today. I can't tell you how profoundly sorry I am that we're here under the circumstances that perhaps bring most of you to today's lecture. Of course, today's event was scheduled well before the events of Paris. There's certainly no prescience or forethought involved, except that this issue, the issue that our distinguished speaker is talking about, has been and deserves to be one of the most important topics on our collective agendas. And that's really why we scheduled this event, and that's really why we are so pleased that Undersecretary Sewall can be with us today to talk about mobilizing against a preeminent challenge of the 21st century, countering violent extremism. As we begin, let me just add to Matt, we are live streaming today's event. People will be watching throughout the world. Please do turn down your cell phones. You are encouraged to tweet out all the brilliant things that you hear. But other than that, please no sounds from the audience. We're very delighted to be able to have today's event. It is the latest in a now multi-year series that we are convening under the auspices of our Stein Program on Counterterrorism and Intelligence, led by our director, our former Wexler Fellow, Matt Levitt. Matt is going to be up here later on to moderate a discussion and Q&A session with our guest. Through this series, we endeavor to bring periodically to this podium leaders from throughout the U.S. government who have a significant role to play in the overall set of issues facing our nation and our allies in terms of terrorism. There really are few more important issues than the profound ideological issue, the profound challenge of countering violent extremism. And in that context, again, I'm delighted that Sarah Sewall can be here today. Undersecretary Sewall is the Undersecretary of State for Civilian Security, Democracy, and Human Rights. And just take a moment and put all those pieces together, because I think that says an awful lot about the connection that I believe is quite appropriate in drawing between these elements, who we are, what this fight is all about, and how we can most effectively counter the challenge that we face. Security, democracy, human rights. Undersecretary Sewall has served in this position since February 2014. She comes to Washington from the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard, where she directed the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy. She's been deeply engaged in issues dealing with the intersection of security, human rights, atrocity. This is a profound set of issues, and I think it is very important and appropriate that for this, the first session that we're convening after the Paris attacks, that we can have someone of Undersecretary Sewall's status and importance in the State Department to address this topic. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Undersecretary of State Sarah Sewall.
Thank you so much, Matt, and thank you to the Washington Institute. It's nice to be here in your beautiful new building. This says don't move the mic, but I'm very nervous. Thank you. That's great. Thank you, everyone, for joining us, and I wish, as Matt said, that our topic were not so timely. A week ago, followers of ISIL brought barbarism to the City of Light. In a coordinated and cowardly act of terror, they slaughtered 132 innocent lives, wounded over 350 other people, and before that, they attacked peaceful shoppers in Beirut, demonstrators in Ankara, vacationers in the Sinai. Earlier this week, suicide bombers struck a market in Kano, killing at least 30 people. And as you know, today gunmen stormed a hotel in Bamako, taking over 170 hostages temporarily. the same time, these grim reminders that after a decade more post 9/11, the global threat of terrorism has not receded. These actions are proof that terrorism has simply reconstituted, and it remains a grave threat to all of us in every part of the globe. And as we grapple with this spate of violence and we steel ourselves for the struggle ahead, we must be careful to heed the lessons of the last decade plus. President Obama said the United States will never shy away from using force to protect our citizens and allies, and we will be intensifying the campaign to degrade and ultimately defeat ISIL with new strikes against their leaders, oil fields, and territory. We have to continue to capture and kill terrorists of all stripes, whether they are fighting in Syria's civil war, fomenting insurgency in Mali or Iraq, plotting in safe havens in Libya, or slaughtering innocents in Nigeria. But we do have to remember, amidst our outrage, that no number of airstrikes, soldiers, or spies can eliminate the complex motives and the hateful ideologies that feed terrorism. And this is what I really want to talk about today, how the United States and a growing number of our partners around the world are mobilizing a broader approach to address the underlying forces that make people vulnerable to the lure of violent extremism. And we call this broader approach countering violent extremism, or CVE in Washington parlance. How did the United States come to push a broader civilian-led preventive effort as an essential complement to our military and intelligence actions against terrorism? And the simple answer is learning. Learning from more than a decade since that searing experience of 9/11, lessons that are particularly relevant in this current moment of heightened international outrage following the most recent spate of attacks. So let me remind us the journey that we've traveled. After September 11, the U.S. arrayed extraordinary military and intelligence tools to dismantle terror networks abroad. And our efforts successfully decimated core al-Qaeda leadership and prevented a catastrophic attack on the homeland. Yet as we targeted al-Qaeda and eliminated key leaders, its remnants dispersed and adapted. Some terrorist groups aligned with aggrieved communities by merging with regional militias or insurgencies. Others entered areas of failed governance and began controlling territory, resources, and populations. Many exploited digital platforms to disseminate their twisted ideologies, recruit vulnerable individuals, and coordinate cells around the world. The rise of ISIL truly epitomizes the evolution and endurance of violent extremism over the last decade, and the complex ways in which it can intertwine with other pre-existing national security challenges like civil conflict and failed states. ISIL's ability to both hold territory with ground forces while simultaneously conducting and inspiring global attacks against soft targets makes it a threat at multiple levels. And the continued spread and resurgence of ISIL's brand underscores that while traditional hard approaches remain vital, they are insufficient for addressing the conditions that make people vulnerable to joining these groups in the first place, whether it's an individual halfway around the world or an entire community that comes to see ISIL as a better bet than its own government. As President Obama has said, our military and intelligence efforts are not going to succeed alone. They have to be matched by political and economic progress to address the conditions that ISIL has exploited in order to take root. And that's the rationale for what our government calls CVE. While non-military means to address ideology or strengthen community resilience to violent extremism are not new, the Obama administration has developed them within a broader, preventive, and civilian-led framework. And it seeks to expand their role in how we address threats of terrorism at home, abroad, and in concert with our international partners. Early in the Obama administration, the United States began expanding our civilian tools to counter terrorist propaganda and build resilience in vulnerable communities. In 2010, we established the Center for Strategic Counterterrorist Communication, or the CSCC, to amplify our counter-messaging efforts across the interagency. A year later, the United States government began piloting development and other projects to build community resilience to violent extremism and to counter radicalization abroad. It helped establish institutions such as HDAYA, the first international center to support civilian-led approaches to counter violent extremism. And while all of these efforts fell under the moniker of CVE, they remained modest, uncoordinated, under-resourced, and lacking an overarching national and international framework. And that's begun to change over the past year as the Obama administration began broadening CVE in our practice at home and with partners abroad in three critical ways that I will outline in turn. The first is the emphasis on prevention. CVE calls for pushing back against the recruitment methods that terrorist groups use to target vulnerable individuals while providing these individuals with off-ramps from the path of radicalization. And in doing so, CVE seeks to tighten the flow of recruits to the current generation of terrorist groups and to better prevent new ones from emerging. CVE also recognizes the need to address the so-called push factors that make people vulnerable to these calls. This means helping governments and communities address the political, social, and economic grievances that terrorists exploit. These grievances vary enormously, which explains how ISIL has drawn recruits from nearly every region and walk of life, from conflict-ridden provinces in western Iraq to working-class neighborhoods in Brussels. Their sources exist at the individual or at the community level, and some of these sources of motivation will be beyond a government's capacity to address. But national governments have a key impact. A recent study showed that over the last 25 years, up to 92% of all terrorist attacks have occurred in countries where state-sponsored violence, like torture and extrajudicial killings, was widespread. By governing effectively and inclusively, upholding the rule of law, respecting human rights, and avoiding heavy-handed responses to terrorist and other security threats, governments can help reduce discontents that are exploited by violent extremist networks to mobilize recruits and support. But of course, grievances cannot alone fully explain, and they can never justify, the rise of violent extremism. Whatever fertile soil enables terrorist radicalization, it is the extremist ideology, extremist propaganda, extremist terror networks that channel people to violence. And a critical piece of CVE's preventative work is pushing back against the twisted beliefs and recruitment tactics that violent extremists wield to influence communities and target vulnerable individuals. We can identify these individuals when they begin their path to radicalization. Law enforcement and community-level interventions can divert them from that path. But this requires constructive relationships between communities at risk and the local officials, relationships that are rooted in mutual respect and trust. When communities feel that they can turn to local officials without fear of persecution, they're more likely to report suspicious activity and to seek assistance for friends and family who are showing the signs of radicalization. Yet such trust and respect are often the key ingredients absent in places that are in the greatest need of such preventive work. As we've seen in the United States with all variety of lone wolf actions who kill fellow citizens in schools or make threats, we lack the strategies to assuredly prevent every individual from descending into violence. For radicalized individuals, imprisonment can be necessary to prevent violence. And at this stage, CVE means ensuring that the time spent behind bars helps individuals rehabilitate. And finally, when former members of violent extremist groups are released from jail or when current members become disillusioned and want out, CVE means finding secure and effective ways to reintegrate them into their communities. CVE encompasses all of these efforts in a preventive, civilian-led framework that must be adapted to local context, because the forces that can fuel violent extremism are remarkably complex, overlapping, and oftentimes only apparent at the community level. Though national governments have a vital role in all of this work, effectively addressing these complex forces requires a much broader set of actors. Which brings me to the second core element of CVE. an emphasis on a whole-of-society approach. CVE calls for broadening the bench in the shared struggle against violent extremism to include local officials, businessmen, women, leaders of religious organizations, researchers, parents, youth, former members, and victims of violent extremist groups. Local leaders are much better positioned to cultivate the relationships and partnerships that we need in local communities. As President Obama said in Ankara earlier this week while discussing our strategy to defeat ISIL, if you do not have local populations that are committed to inclusive governance and who are pushing back against ideological extremes, they resurface. And what does a whole-of-society CVE effort look like? Essentially, it's reinforced trust and cooperation among government and people, with local actors empowered to contribute to the shared struggle. Mainstream religious leaders are critical CVE actors for several reasons. They can teach the tenets of faith to vulnerable youth who are searching for spiritual guidance. But mainstream religious voices feel too vulnerable to speak out, or who lack the tools to communicate widely, they require assistance, and CVE efforts can help protect and empower them as messengers of tolerance. CVE, civil society, can help youth develop a sense of purpose through civic engagement. And women are often the first to detect warning signs of radicalization, and they can play a key role in helping off-ramp children into alternative opportunities. Young people are some of the most persuasive voices against violent extremism among their peers, and few have greater credibility to debunk terrorist lies and propaganda than the former members and victims of violent extremist groups. So these are examples of the ways in which you can recruit different and complementary aspects of civil society to become part of this whole-of-society effort. The U.S. has shifted its CVE efforts at home and galvanized a global movement to reflect this whole-of-society approach. As the CSCC steps up efforts to push back against terrorist propaganda online, it now does more to empower credible voices outside government by connecting them with at-risk individuals and equipping them with effective counter-messages. A recent campaign under the hashtag #WhyTheyLeftDash gave defectors a platform to dissuade potential recruits by exposing the brutality of life under the so-called Islamic State. Actors outside of national government have also assumed greater roles in this shared struggle. Earlier this year, young leaders from every region gathered at the first ever Global Youth CVE Summit to showcase the innovative tools that they developed to counter the appeal of violent extremism among their peers. At home in the United States, in Boston, Minneapolis, and Los Angeles, we've seen local officials partner with educators, social service providers, academics, and community leaders to build resilience to violent extremism through holistic and tailored responses. Last September, mayors from around the world launched the Strong Cities Network to exchange good practices for building local resilience against violent extremism. Today, in Aarhus, Denmark, the network's wrapping up its first event to explore how best to develop city-level tools and partnerships for CVE. Local communities are truly on the front line of this struggle, and few cities appreciate this more so than Paris. So it's fitting that Paris will host the network's first annual summit next spring. The attacks in Mali, in Paris, before that in Beirut and Ankara, underscore the global reach of violent extremism. And the breadth of this threat suggests the importance of directing our CVE efforts effectively, which brings me to the third aspect of CVE, which is the need to focus on the most vulnerable individuals and communities using evidence-based approaches. No government can fully eliminate discontents and grievances that terrorists exploit to recruit individuals or mobilize whole communities. Here in the United States, the case of individual lone wolves who have no prior affiliation with ISIL's nominal aims, let alone with Islam, are a growing concern that shows the difficulty, just as does that rash of school shootings I mentioned earlier, of prevention at an individual level. But where there's evidence that terrorist propaganda is luring recruits, we should prioritize our CVE efforts to help communities protect their children from the siren call of violent extremism. Identifying those vulnerabilities and the underlying factors requires rigorous analysis and research, which are also vital for measuring the impact of the CVE responses so that we can continue to learn what works most effectively and invest and adapt the most effective approaches. We still have much to learn, but we're making very important progress. On the international CVE front, for example, the Department of State recently established a new unit within the Bureau of Conflict and Stabilization Operations to analyze the underlying drivers of violent extremism in different global contexts to help us better diagnose the problems and direct our responses. This analysis feeds into a new state initiative to develop CVE programming through an integrated and holistic process across the department. Now states launching CVE pilot programs in Africa that are focused on the most at-risk communities and on the key drivers of radicalization using carefully tailored, evidence-based approaches. We also look to actors outside government, like the Washington Institute, for contributions to this research and analysis. Just a few months ago, I attended the launch for Resolve, a new network for researchers, especially those at the local level, to share their findings and resources as they uncover community-level drivers of violent extremism and identify the most effective remedies to address them. I encourage all of you in this room, including the Institute, to support this network by contributing your own scholarship or by mentoring local researchers. In summary, these three tenets of CVE are preventing more individuals and communities from aligning with violent extremist movements, partnering with a broader range of actors for a whole-of-society approach, and third, focusing on the most vulnerable communities. In doing so, CVE seeks to move U.S. counterterrorism toward a more proactive, affirmative, and preventive approach. This complements our hard security efforts because by containing the spread of terrorist threats, CVE makes it more likely that our hard security approaches can succeed. It's not a question of either drone strikes in Libya, global campaign against ISIL, or CVE. The complex and generational threat of violent extremism demands both. Over the last 2 years, the Obama administration has dramatically elevated CVE in the international agenda and has focused the world on the need for more holistic civilian-led efforts to prevent the rise and spread of violent extremism. This effort kicked into high gear last February at the White House Summit on Countering Violent Extremism, where representatives, for the first time, from foreign governments, multilateral bodies, civil society, business, and the faith community, for the first time came together to talk about these broader dimensions of the struggle against violent extremism. And they outlined a concrete action agenda to put the CVE approach into action around the world. And when participants gathered again this past September on the margins of the UN General Assembly to review the progress that had been made, the global CVE movement had grown to more than 100 countries, 20 multilateral bodies, and 120 civil society groups with much to report. Governments in every region had stepped up to engage new state and municipal governments, civil society, and the private sector around their CVE action agenda. Several countries had developed national CVE action plans with meaningful roles for non-governmental actors. The United Arab Emirates established a regional messaging center to counter violent extremist propaganda. And Nigeria, Malaysia, and the Organization for Islamic Cooperation have announced plans to do the same. Multilateral bodies like the World Bank and the United Nations have become increasingly engaged in CVE. And in the coming months, UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon will release his plan of action to mobilize a whole of UN response to violent extremism. That plan will outline steps for all UN bodies and for member states to continue contributing to this shared struggle. While these developments are hopeful, they're positive, we're mindful of the enormous challenges ahead. It's no secret that many of our closest partners for counterterrorism may publicly welcome a more civilian-led approach, but in practice continue to rely on short-term and often heavy-handed responses that do little to address the underlying conditions that enable violent extremism to take root. The Obama administration will continue to press the case for CVE around the world, fully aware that changes in government behavior require tough and persistent engagement, and we are at the beginning of a new approach. Even as the President has committed the U.S. to military efforts, we will not shy away from explaining to our international partners how respecting human rights, upholding the rule of law, and empowering civil society are inseparable from the larger struggle against violent extremism. In fact, our own in-house analyses show that violent extremist groups are up to four times more likely to emerge in states that do not respect human rights. During Secretary Kerry's recent trip to Central Asia, he echoed this point, warning that terrorism is not a legitimate excuse to lock up political opponents, diminish the rights of civil society, or pin false labels on activists who are engaged in peaceful dissent. Practices of this type are not only unjust, but counterproductive. They play directly into the hands of terrorists. So too, warned President Obama, does xenophobic rejection of Syrian refugees, which is a rejection of our fundamental values and feeds directly into terrorist narratives. The CVE effort becomes especially critical during this moment of heightened grief and anger. As the world demands justice for ISIL's most recent crimes and continued savagery, can become easy and expeditious to rely exclusively on hard security actions in a quest for perceived immediate results. And similarly, it can be tempting to invoke counterterrorism as a pretext to disregard human rights and discount more complex long-term approaches. So as we intensify the global campaign against ISIL's territory, finances, and followers abroad, we can't lose sight of the fundamental truth that no bomb, bullet, or wiretap can address the complex factors and hateful ideologies that feed violent extremism. We, the international community, will break violent extremism through not only our force of arms, but by upholding international values and empowering local communities. Thanks, and I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much. That was a fantastic tour de force, and it raised lots of different ideas for conversation. I'd like to take the moderator's prerogative and ask one, save a few more for later. Rob may want to do the same. First of all, I want to accept your call for the Washington Institute's continued research in this area. I think that's really important for a couple of reasons. First of all, when things happen as they have in the past few days, people call for more of the obvious. We must do more to combat terror financing. We must do more to counter violent extremism. But they don't necessarily come up with tangibles. And so some of the efforts that you mentioned and a host of others that are actually trying to do this from a research agenda, bottom-up approach, are very, very welcome. So when the G20 this week called for recognizing the need to proactively prevent violent extremism, they don't really know what to do with that, and it's incumbent upon those of us who are doing research in this area to provide them some ideas. At the Institute, we've been doing that for a long time, and because there's a camera here, I'll just throw up a couple of those. Our first one on rewriting the narrative in 2009, and the one that followed fighting the ideological battle in 2010. These were great, but they got people's attention for a little while, and then not. And if we can call a spade for a good few years, and some of you who were working on these issues at the same time as I was, remember, no one wanted to talk about this. This was not a sexy topic. No one wanted to pay attention. And the friend of many of ours who's at that White House with this on their plate would joke that that person had six items on their plate and this was the seventh. And so the fact that this has taken a turn and we are now seriously thinking about this is wonderful. And so we're continuing to do great work on this, and we welcome that call, and we will answer it. I participated in the White House CVE Summit. In fact, the Washington Institute participated. There were a handful of civil society events around town the Friday after, and we hosted one on rehabilitation of foreign terrorist fighters. I'll save my question on that for a few minutes from now. But when we had that event, one of the people we had here was Gilles de Kerckhove, the EU counterterrorism coordinator. And he, as a European, highlighted something that we here in the United States tend not to, and you also did not so much just now. And that is specifically the fact that although the Islamic State is not particularly Islamic at all, and that this has not to do, this is not driven by religion, this is a terrorist group that is claiming to do things in the name of religion, and its ideology is grounded in its radical interpretation of religion, not to be confused with mainstream religion. When Gilles was here, he said, for example, many imams in Europe do not speak the language of their host country, and they may be fostering a very conservative interpretation of Islam. So as I was listening to you, I was thinking, so how do I structure what you just described? And I put it this way, if I may. There are grievances of all kinds. There are local grievances. There are international grievances. Those are somehow sometimes referred to as push factors. And they provide a cognitive opening. But something has to seep into that cognitive opening, or else you have people who are upset. We all get upset about things all the time. And that has to be some type of mobilizing ideology. And the mobilizing ideology that we're talking about is being framed in religious terms as a siren call, as you described it. And that then operationalizes people. Without that ideology, people are not mobilized. They are not doing. So what I heard in your talk was very insightful thoughts about working with local communities on the local grievances, and I assume also working with them on the ideology. But what I'd like to draw you out on a little bit more is we need to address the grievances, to be sure. We also need to find ways to address the ideology. What more can we do about that without buying into a debate over religion, which this should not be?
So thanks. I think that, you know, CVE recognizes that the pull factors, which is how I would describe any ideology that is a siren call to actualization of violence on the part of individuals or community, that the pull factors have to be addressed. We in the sort of history of how we evolved CVE elements, the first that we recognized was the need to counter ideology. And that was conceived of largely as a question of counter narrative and a provision of a debunking of myths and claims and the provision of more accurate information, whether it was about geopolitics or whether it was about claims about theology. Obviously, the United States or secular states are not the best positioned to have authority in that conversation. And that is why, and that is, I think, how our communications approach has evolved, the need to empower other voices that have greater authority to provide alternative interpretations of religious texts, but also to provide alternative authority figures and paths of actualization for those who are the seekers being pulled to the ideology is so important. This can be tricky to do because by virtue of providing resources or support to those voices, one could be perceived as discrediting the authenticity of those voices. So this is a tricky tightrope to walk. But you're absolutely right that the ideology is the spark, if you will, and that CVE efforts recognize that and seek to address that, both through the communication strategies, but also through the community engagement strategies. And that will continue to be true regardless of the ideology at function when you're talking about what makes people move from being aggrieved and vulnerable to being empowered to and motivated to take action.
Okay, thank you very much. Rob, you want to jump in before we go to the audience?
Thank you. I'm going to take the prerogative to ask the traditional terminology question. This past week, Hillary Clinton and Jeb Bush both gave speeches on this topic in general. Hillary Clinton, former Secretary of State, used the term jihadists as her framing of the nature of the problem. Jeb Bush used the term radical Islamic terrorists as his framing of the problem. Government, and this text represents this, is actually, I think it was very, very useful and insightful text, focuses on violent extremism as the framing of the problem. It dawns on me as I was listening to the text that, in fact, if we didn't use the word, if we didn't use the acronym ISIL, but actually read out the full name of the organization, it would sound very different, because Islamic State would appear dozens of times as opposed to just the acronym. Do you see, or how would you, what is the rationale today of avoiding the terminology that former Secretary of State Clinton used, Jeb Bush uses, in favor of using only the terminology of violent extremism?
So thanks for that question, and there's been a lot of hoopla around that question. And I want to differentiate between the policies that the U.S. has in place to deal with specific threats and the terminology that we use to create a global movement in which the lessons that are learned about what radicalizes people to violence can be applicable in many global theaters. So, for example, at the regional conference that Norway hosted, which was about countering violent extremism, their touchstone for they're very concerned about Daesh, but their touchstone in the Norwegian context for violent extremism was a white supremacist attack on nearly 100 school children. So if you want to build a violent extremist movement that can bring, whether they are in Asia dealing with Buddhist nationalism or whether they are thinking about neo-Nazi threats, all elements of the threat picture into building capacity to deal with things that include very specific threats like Daesh or Al-Qaeda or Boko Haram, then you want to use inclusive language. That has no bearing on or no dilution from the U.S.'s commitment to eliminating Daesh or fighting Al-Qaeda. And so I'm intrigued by a focus on terminology at the expense of looking at actions, because the president's been very clear about the enemies and focus of the military campaigns that he has been leading since 9/11. And I think that's really what the American people care about, is being safe and making sure that our military activities are directed at those that pose the most imminent threats to Americans and our allies around the world.
I'm going to open this up now. Please wait till a mic comes, and I'll call everybody in the order that I see them. And so we'll start right here with Doug, and then we'll come over here.
Secretary Sewall, thank you for that presentation. I'm Doug Fife, now a senior fellow at Hudson Institute. If you'll permit, two quick questions. I want to ask you something about the work that you're doing. But before I get to that, I was struck by especially your comment now about thinking of this problem inclusively and covering various acts of violent extremism, including, you know, white supremacists in Norway. When you listed recent acts of violent extremism, you talked about Mali, Paris, Sinai, Iraq, Syria, Beirut. In recent weeks, there have been more or less 100 or more incidents of people being stabbed on the streets, Israelis being stabbed on the streets in various cities in Israel. It was a remarkable omission when you talk about what's happened in recent months in the field of violent extremism. And I'm curious, why did you omit? Do you categorize those acts differently from all of these other acts that you're calling violent extremism? That's one question. The other question
Which acts do I characterize differently?
The stabbings, the spate of stabbings and axe attacks in various cities in Israel over recent months, I mean, since early October or so.
If
I could, and then I'll just quickly ask the other question I had, which is the one that I started with before I heard that listing. You talked about a fact-based approach to this campaign, and I'm wondering, do you have some kind of historical model in mind that, I mean, has anybody ever done this before, a campaign against violent extremism? Are there some international movements in the past that you consider to be models that you can build on, or is this do you view this as kind of a unique current project?
So I think, thank you, Doug, for the questions. I think the list that we make of attacks against innocent civilians motivated by ideology could be much longer than the recent examples that I just mentioned.
I picked the singular examples with high numbers of casualties that have happened recently. So it could be a much more expansive list, and it would include many more countries, and it would include many more actors. So that's the answer to your question. In terms of the momentum and the structure that is emerging around countering violent extremism, I think there are a couple ways that one could think about it. It exists at the normative level, where we have had many similar evolutions of international norms that have evolved slowly and imperfectly, I might add, over time. I would put human rights in that category. So the consciousness that begins to emerge is followed by a lag in practice, but hopefully then reinforces itself over time as people move to better align their activities with the norm. Here, the norm is one in which we say we want to complement the short-term actions that we take to kill and capture terrorists with a depletion of the fertile ground in which future terrorists can be created. So I think there is a normative aspect to it. There is also a very concrete applied aspect to it that I think will take some time to develop, in part because we are at the very early stages of trying to build the capacities to take the actions to align with the norms that we're just now talking about since February. This is really new. And the way I look at it is that, you know, I don't want my children to be fighting the children of the current terrorists decades from now. I want to be able to contain that threat by thinking proactively and, frankly, by doing things that we believe in, which is helping to create community resilience, helping to protect citizens from the lure of nihilistic activity. And that will allow our current efforts, whether they're against Daesh or al-Qaeda, or whether they're someone else's efforts against violent extremists in their own country, to be more successful. So there is, you could compare the evolution in on both an architecture angle and on a normative angle to any number of ways the international community has evolved in its thinking, whether they're about aspirations like human rights or whether they're about building coalitions to address threats. But I think the interesting thing is that we are very much in the early stages, and I think the UN's Prevention Plan of Action hopefully can provide a continued mechanism to hold governments to account for including the preventive piece in their responsive and reactive pieces, and continuing to keep that conversation inclusive so that we think, as Ban Ki-moon urged member states in February at the White House summit on countering violent extremism, to make sure that we are always asking whether or not the second and third order effects of state responses to terrorism are in effect enhancing our efforts long term. In other words, to be always conscious and mindful of the relationship between our immediate response and the longer term preventive objectives that we have.
Thank you. Right up here, and we're gonna come around. I see you next, don't worry.
Thank you. Hassan Amnemi, Fikra Forum. Both radicalization and counter-radicalization effort are essentially a battle to move the demarcation line. I mean, very often, radicalization efforts try to say it is us Muslims globally, the whole Ummah, against the U.S., against the West, so pushing the demarcation line into a civilizational one, while de-radicalization efforts are an attempt to say it is this, all of us civic citizens against those few radicals, etc. It seems to me that the assumption in the countering violent extremism about where the demarcation line stands to start with is a little bit too optimistic, along the lines that all three components that you have described do not take into account the fact that the demarcation line might be far less in our favor than it seems to be assumed, along the lines that there's an underlying current of anti-Americanism that not only makes suspect any action, but allows a certain toleration of, let's say, an engagement on the part of governments and even on the part of civil society, but with a certain level of doubt or even beyond doubt. So my question to you would be, to what extent, before the question, actually just mentioning in that respect, how now there's a whole category referred to by radicals, even not, I'm not talking about violent radicals, of a RAND Islam, an Islam that is tailor-made along the RAND recommendations of the 1990s, along the lines that empowering moderate voices. And this is completely discredited. To what extent an effort that is clearly perceived as being one by, if you'd like, despite the fact that it's claiming to be bottom-up, it is financed and fueled by a top-down, to what extent do you expect it to be successful? I mean, how do you counter that, the whole notion that that the underlying anti-Americanism will effectively keep on discrediting much of these efforts?
Thank you. I think you point out, you make a very good point, which is that we have to be extremely sensitive both to the realities of perception or the impact of perception, and we have to be innovative in trying to find ways to genuinely empower grassroots rather than be perceived as providing top-down solutions. I think it's very important to differentiate, though, between what constitutes anti-Americanism and what constitutes anti-state and what constitutes other forms of potential resistance to this approach. And I think that in the emphasis on the need for actors other than government and in the emphasis on the need for very localized responses to whatever the particular needs or vulnerabilities of a community are, there lies the potential for this movement itself, this response, to move beyond the United States, certainly, but to move beyond states themselves. As a former international relations professor, I find it fascinating that what has begun to emerge alongside of the network of states that know how to have conferences and coalitions and come together, and we have the counter-ISIL coalition, and it has regular meetings, and it has an infrastructure and all the rest of it. But when we think about CVE, how do we think about a whole of society approach? What's the scaffolding or the architecture by which people who aren't states can engage in a parallel effort that goes alongside of the state process that we apply to so many problem sets? So one of the things that I think is most encouraging about the White House-led summit process is the creation of networks for civil society actors for actors that are not national governments, but our localities. So the Strong Cities Network is one such example. The Youth Network, Global Youth Network, is another such example, where we are beginning to, and these organizations, while they may receive funding from multiple sources, including governments, including foundations, including private sector, they'll have diversified funding and they'll have independent, almost wiki activity. So they're not going to be controlled by a state or by a central national perspective. And they are platforms for learning to encourage local responses. You're absolutely right that there will always be a tension between the ability of a community within itself to protect its youth and protect its belief systems against those who disguise themselves as aligning with other concerns of those communities. But those aren't things that the United States or that states themselves are best positioned to address. So we're in a very interesting era where we necessarily must rely on actors who are different from those that we have typically used to solve international problems or that can be controlled at the state level to provide that inoculation within local communities against this virulent external action. And so I think it's a very important development in how we think about the long-term solutions to these problems. I think it's one of the reasons why the United States no longer sees itself as the prime mover, and it's very hopeful that the United Nations is beginning to play a bigger role, and that some of the institutions that we have created to play on terrorism are going to begin to bring civil society and other actors into a state-sponsored structure. So ultimately, this is an area of innovation and adaptation that will be experimenting with different models of global governance, for lack of a better word, but it's really local empowerment that's being manifest at a global level.
I'll go right here in the middle back, please. I'm Michael Kam, and then we'll come to my colleague, Mohammed Dajani.
Thank you. I'm Oliver Kim. I'm a reporter for the Austrian newspaper Die Presse in Washington. Maybe I didn't grasp your answer, but the question about the role of anti-Americanism in many Arabic societies and in big parts of the Muslim world in general that my predecessor posed to you is for me still open, so if you could comment on that. And then secondly, how do you measure the whether what you do works? How do you measure the success of your work? Because I don't have the impression that since 2010, when the White House apparently seriously kicked off the counter-violence extremism policy, I don't have the impression that this has become a smaller problem if we just look at recent events. Is there any way of measuring it, whether what you do is doing any active?
So let me answer the last question first, because I'm not sure what the first question is.
Yeah, I mean, the role of anti-Americanism, and I'm sorry, but the role of your government in the Middle East for many decades does, I think, play a role. I mean, you support the Egyptian military junta that pushed away a democratically elected government that is probably not to our liking.
But what's, I mean, they were elected. What's the question?
Yeah, I mean, the role of anti-American sentiment and the role of the U.S. in the region, in your work in countering the violence. I mean, this is, I think, what is galvanizing many of these violent jihadists, Islamists, whatever you might call them. I mean, that's an issue, isn't it?
So I think that let me try to respond to the case of Egypt in particular, because it's I'm not sure what the broader question is. But if the question is how does U.S. foreign policy affect our counterterrorism and countering violent extremism efforts, is that it's complicated. And that in many cases where we have partners who are struggling with very virulent local domestic threats, they are seized with the desire for kinetic responses and immediate results. That is not something with which we are unfamiliar from the 9/11 period. We have evolved in our response to terrorism, and we have been able to see what is counterproductive in the long run and adapt accordingly, not perfectly, of course, but we have evolved. We believe that many of our partners will similarly evolve, and it is the U.S. view that we should be working with them to help them understand the second and third order effects of their actions that could be counterproductive to their pursuit of security. That's a fundamental reality within which we work in the current environment. And so in some cases, that will be perceived as happening too slowly. But it doesn't change the fact that it's the goal of U.S. foreign policy, and we think it's better than the alternatives. In terms of the second question, you'll have to remind me now.
Measuring.
So the U.S. began experimenting with domestic, international CVE programs in 2010. But as I said, they were small scale, they were under-resourced, they were ad hoc, and they were dispersed, and they were not adequately measured. One of the reasons why we have focused on the research network coming out of the White House summit process is that we are very much in the early stages of beginning to understand what works and what doesn't work in particular circumstances. And as in any new field of endeavor, it will take some time and some adaptation to know what works and what doesn't work. What's really critical about the kinds of interventions I mentioned that we're doing, a very new pilot project in East Africa around the Al-Shabaab problem set, in which the monitoring and evaluation features critically into the whole design of that effort, precisely so that we can build a better knowledge base that may or may not be very attributable to areas outside of East Africa because of the localized nature of each challenge, but nonetheless has to be the basis for collective learning going forward. What participants in the White House summit all agreed is that no one could afford to be learning independently. We all had to be learning together. That's why the research network exists. There is too much urgency to getting this better immediately, and so the ability to share across different parts of the world and in different problem sets what is more and less effective on countering violent extremism is the whole purpose of the new process that we've launched. And so it's evolving.
Excellent. Mohammed Dajani, and then we're going to come to Mia over here, and then I see two more over here. We'll get everybody.
Mohammed Dajani, Western Fellow at the Washington Institute. Physics teaches us that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. And actually, if we look at the terrorism that is taking place in Paris and in other places, it is having a very strong reaction within here in the American community. And we can see that in a lot of activities that has been taken in which there is Islamophobia and the xenophobia, and the people are now even on the candidates who are inciting against Muslims. Trump is saying we have to put a database for them, and maybe later he might want them to be in concentration camps, like, or internment camps. And Carson was saying that they, the Syrian refugees are like rapid dogs, or some of them. And there is a Congress which took decision against the Syrian refugees or the refugees to block them out. Unfortunately, there is a lot of incitement that's taking place now against Muslims. And if we look in Germany, the Holocaust did not happen in a vacuum. It was preceded by anti-Semitic incitement. In Rwanda, against the Tutsis, it was preceded by incitement. My question is, what is being done in order that this incitement will be contained, that it will not end up in massacres and genocides for Muslims in the United States?
Thanks for a very thoughtful question. You know, one of the other hats that I wear in my current role is responsibility for helping the State Department think about the prevention of mass atrocities. And as you point out, dehumanizing language and dismissive collective mobilization at a rhetorical level is often a precursor to violent acts, and is precisely the kind of thing that can embolden individual actors that we were just discussing in the context of this speech. So it's very disappointing when political leaders harness sectarian differences or differences of any kind in ways that could be seen as incitement to violence. And I will refrain from characterizing any of the specific statements in the U.S., but it's certainly a troubling trend. I think I am really drawn to the comments that I believe Senator John McCain made, that you know, we are all God's children. And President Obama has also spoken out, warning that this kind of rejectionist and demeaning and dehumanizing language plays into the Daesh narrative. In fact, I was meeting with an ambassador earlier this week who made the exact same point. So it is very troubling. But as you know, the United States has a long commitment to the freedom of speech, and that is an unshakable commitment. And so the U.S. government itself is unlikely to be doing a great deal about statements that are expressed with regard to certain policy issues. And hopefully we won't be in a position in which they resemble the very reasons why we're talking about violent extremism rather than jihadi, Wahhabist radicalism, because violent extremism can come in many forms.
I would just add that another input to this, of course, is that our adversaries, whether it's Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State, do want overreactions of a kind that they hope will drive further people into their arms. We should not be feeding into that. Mia.
Hi, thank you so much for your presentation, and it's really beautiful building. My name is Mia Bloom. I'm a professor at Georgia State University. To follow on from the previous statement, and I told this to Sarah beforehand. She did ask me to share it with you. I was asked to be on a number of news shows, so you're probably sick of hearing about female suicide bombers. But they asked me, has anything been reported incorrectly? And the freedom of speech doesn't seem to go in both directions, because in the pre-interview with Fox News for this morning, when I said the issue of refugees hasn't been reported accurately, there have been 750,000 refugees that have entered the United States since 9/11. Not one is a terrorist. I've been studying terrorism for almost as long as Matt, 25 years. not a lot of refugee terrorists, and also of the mass casualty shooters that we've studied, not one terrorist. So I did want to say that just so that you have the data, and we would be happy to share it with you. But speaking of data, you know, Dr. John Horgan and I have worked on the CVE programs to compare the Yemen Committee on Dialogue, the Saudi program, the programs in Colombia, around the world. One of the problems that is missing, and I don't think Hidayah necessarily addresses this, is there's no metrics for evaluation. First of all, what's defined as who gets in? In the Saudi case, you have very low-hanging fruit. Everyone's claiming a 99 to 100% success rate. And so part of the problem, not to put pressure on you, is that there are no funds for the implementation of CVE or to really study this issue. I will say that we have one really good program in the U.S. if you want to use it in terms of they do evaluate. Montgomery County here in Maryland has done a fantastic job of bridging the community, working with the police, working with the Muslim community, outreach. And so it's not part of the city's initiative, but it is a great template, and it's very close by if you ever want to visit them.
Thanks for that, Mia. So you are right to point out that there is data, and there is data, but I think that the interest on the part of many people is in what we can do internationally as well as what we can do abroad, and our international data is not as strong because we haven't, for our own programming, been as effective in capturing it. So I think there are still important gaps to fill, but we're not working from a tabula rasa. We are, though, often comparing apples and oranges. So, for example, I think you were referring to evaluating de-radicalization programs. That's quite different from trying to evaluate whether or not in a given community, say, among the Swahili-speaking population on the Kenya coast, you've managed to, through programs X, Y, and Z, actually increase trust with the local police. That's the kind of metric that we are, in fact, now developing for our new pilot in East Africa. So I don't think it's that these can't be developed at all. I just think that it's very early in these days, and I'm really grateful that you mentioned funding, because that gives me a chance to make a plug, and I don't have a glossy pamphlet to hold up, but I can say that if you look at the hundreds of billions of dollars that have been spent confronting a very real terrorist threat, and you compare the investments that we've made, which I'm fully supportive of, on the military intelligence and law enforcement side, and then you compare that to the investments that we've made on the community resilience and inoculation and prevention side, you can't find the bar. And so, you know, we have tried to, we have sought funding in the past, the administration has sought funding in the past for State Department and USAID programming precisely on CVE. It has been rejected by the Congress in the past. We are hopeful that Congress will fund a modest amount, not what we had suggested, but $100 million. And I did say hundreds of billions of dollars, $100 million request for the coming fiscal year. But this is a grossly under-resourced area. And I think it comes from, and this, you know, this is not unique to the counterterrorism field. I think in general, the United States has been, has found it as a political matter harder to see a constituency and a political self-interest in supporting foreign assistance and softer tools than on the harder side. I think this is particularly acute on this problem set. And if we all recognize that the way out of the box is that you have to contain it rather than watch it spread and run to play catch-up all the time, we're going to have to deal with this question of resources. And so for all those in this room, I urge you to educate yourself on this issue, because I think it is much more than definitions or the conceptual frame or this country and bilateral relationships. This is what fundamentally holds us back from moving out and making progress in an area that we all recognize is vital to the security of ourselves and the next generation of Americans and friends globally.
You're giving me the eyes you wanted to jump in, or are we good?
Well, I'll wait for one or two others.
Okay, good. So we have this gentleman here in the back. And then we're going to go to Mike Kraft.
Thank you. Henry Hatker.
I see someone here back here, too. We'll get everybody, I promise.
Henry Hatker, research, now retired government. I wondered, in your opinion, when a non-state actor, which ISIS has been called, becomes a government, is now battling two superpowers and another nuclear power. Not that they're going to use nuclear weapons, but just to signify how powerful they are. The Confederacy did not achieve any diplomatic recognition within our own boundaries, yet was a very powerful government. Would it be considered a non-state actor, or is it a government of some form? We didn't recognize it, even we didn't, but we were willing to work with them, try to negotiate an end to the war. I wondered what your feelings are on this and what, you know, maybe the State Department itself has to say about this. Another question, how many returning veterans do we have in our country from ISIS? The man who was the leader in Paris was one of those veterans. He had a shady past, lived in Belgium, was in jail a good deal of the time for one reason or another, and then became very successful with ISIS and became a commander. And finally became an intelligence type right there in Paris, and a saboteur, of course. Do we have anybody in our country like that, possibly? And we might somehow be able to pinpoint them through the help of the State Department?
So because you are a former government official, I can remind you that I do not have my own opinions. And the United States does not have a position at what point a non-state actor becomes a state, to the best of my knowledge. But again, I would come back to this question of does it make a difference? I think what is puzzling about the current political discourse and much of the news coverage about these issues is that Daesh is a threat on multiple fronts. Daesh is a threat because it exists on the ground and it controls territory and resources and people, and it fights a set of battles on the ground in which it's actually killed more people on the ground in Syria and Iraq than it has through terrorist attacks outside of that theater. So it's a threat there, and that obviously has huge destabilizing implications and a whole set of factors associated with it, but it's obviously also a threat because it operates at a virtual level also, where it both seems to be connected to and in some cases simply inspiring attacks that are dispersed across the globe, which is really what is the current animation of outrage. So regardless of what we call it or what it is, it's a threat and it has to be countered at multiple levels. And again, you know, the CVE piece both contains it on the ground if done properly, but also counters it in that virtual space that it operates by helping communities identify where the penetration is being made and where youth are being lured and motivated. And so CVE really does apply both to the counter-ISIL coalition at both levels, and it applies more broadly to threats beyond ISIL per se. And so I think we really do have to focus on the threat and the responses. But I don't have an answer to your question. What's the second one again? Sorry.
Are there any veterans of the bad guys?
I would have to refer you to someone else to give you a non-answer on that.
A long list of potential people.
The latest public information is about 250 Americans have gone. Some are still there. Some may be dead. There are very few, but there are some who've come back, and they are being watched closely.
But I think what's fundamentally important to understand, too, in terms of putting things into context, is that we have had, and I forget the facts, but someone in the audience may know them from the recent report, we have had more attacks that against civilians in the name of ideology that has nothing to do with Islam or ISIL than we have from what we all identify as the significant threat that ISIL is. So it is, again, a question of sort of how you define the problem of terrorism or violent extremism and what you see. And we do tend to sometimes apply a narrow lens.
I've got a mic craft right here in the middle.
Thank you very much for the overview. On my craft, I go back to State Department Counterterrorism Office back in the early days when Secretary Shultz tried to start the first public diplomacy campaign against terrorism, which faded away and then it's been revented a couple times. In those days, it was somewhat similar. We dealt with the secular terrorists like Abu Nidal organization and tried to deglamorize them, which led to a number of laws. But currently, you mentioned you're trying to counter the ideology and the narratives, but how do you deal with the psychological aspects of many of the, especially the foreign fighters? As Jessica Stern, who wrote a book recently on ISIS, talked about, a lot of these foreign fighters seem to try to be reinventing themselves, both the women and, I mean, some of the women and the men. And there seems to be a psychological component. You know, people grow up in these areas of Manchester and Brussels and Paris and humdrum lives and trying to glamorize themselves. A, how can you really deal with that? And then secondly, on the financing part, having dealt with Congress on trying to get funding for ATA and other programs, I wish you luck. And I hope you can schedule a lot of, you know, briefings with key staffers and try to get that going. But anyway, I want to get back to the ideological issue. How do you deal with that?
So the psychology of recruitment is probably the most complex, or it's certainly as complex as any other aspect of the threat assessment process. And we know a lot about individual factors that have affected specific people who have become radicalized. We have an enormous amount of data on that. But there is no silver bullet for prevention. And I think that what's interesting is that the kinds of psychological predispositions to violent extremism of any form are hidden often from the closest to the individual. What we have found is incredibly important is improving the ability of those who are around those individuals to detect those signs early. And this is where the notion of trying to identify those who are at risk and providing off-ramps, because there are so many elements that may come into play at an individual psychological level for why someone would be drawn to violent extremism. So I think the most effective means that we have from an individual psychological perspective is not thinking that we can prevent people from having these psychological preconditions, but instead from recognizing when their thought patterns begin to change before those thoughts are translated into action.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. My name is Fahad Nazar. I'm a political analyst here in Vienna, Virginia. About a year ago, Saudi Arabia gave the UN Counterterrorism Center a $100 million donation. And my question is, how closely is the United States working with the UN Center? Frankly, I get the sense that their work is shrouded in secrecy for some reason. Thank you.
There are probably folks in the room, including on my crack counterterrorism team, who know more than I do in that regard. I have not interacted with them at all. I think it's interesting that it's located in Vienna, right? Not in Riyadh?
It's
in New York, but it's not in Riyadh. Anyway, so I invite those in the audience who know more than I do to speak as to whether or not we're working closely with them.
Simply driven by Riyadh's interests.
Are they actually located? Where are they located? I think that would be
it's located in New York. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you, Eric. Yes.
Yeah, this is Mohammed Abdelaziz from Fikr Forum. It seems that the civil society is going to be a very essential partner in your program and it's going to play a very important role. Yeah. How would you do that while you have a very weak civil society, which is suppressed, which has nothing, which has no access to funding, and you already have like four international American organizations who have been convicted in Egypt without taking any action. How would you partner with a weak civil society? I think the civil society needs to be free before being empowered.
No, that's a very fair point, and the circumstances obviously differ from country to country significantly. When the Secretary was most recently in Central Asia, this was a huge topic for him in terms of seeking to explain to the state that they actually needed to provide the space to civil society so that civil society could become a partner in solving what was a whole of society problem. But as I mentioned earlier, Many states are of the opinion and are historically informed view erroneously that that terrorism can justify restricting that space. And we don't believe that that is a long-term, sustainable, preventive approach when it comes to addressing the threat of violent extremism. And so this is something that, depending on the circumstances of individual countries, we can do more or we can do less. One of the meaningful things about the summit, I think, and for anyone who was there, I think it was really a remarkable experience to see some governments who never dealt with civil society having to sit in the same room around a table in which civil society had seats at the table. For many civil society actors who were part of either the Washington meeting or the New York meeting or the seven regional summits or other events that were held, this was the first chance many civil society organizations had had to interact with their governments and to give them a piece of their mind about what the what was problematic about the absence or the activities of state security or the vulnerability of the moderate mosque in their town compared to other facilities or other elements. And so it's very much a work in progress of uneven effect. The tricky part, of course, is resourcing, and one of the reasons why we have been seeking to get the private sector engaged is that the private sector, while obviously perceived to have its own interests, is potentially less loaded a partner for civil society groups than a central government may be, and the private sector has an interest in stability and a particular role to play in terms of oftentimes things like vocational planning, training, and placement that can be at the outer edge of some of the youth programs that are important alternatives to radicalization. So the World Economic Forum has been playing an interesting role and is still processing how it can be helpful in this regard. We really believe that when we say whole of society, it needs to be everyone, because governments can do many things that that business can't do, but vice versa, and civil society is essential to all of this. But you're right to point out the differences and the difficulties.
We have a question right here.
So somebody mentioned budget, you mentioned budget constraints and how there's a lot of support for the law enforcement, the high up aggressive approach versus the more preventative approach. And I was struck by just when I was on my Facebook page this morning, I noticed how, since I was a sociology major, my perspective of what pops up is much different than, say, somebody else who has different friend groups and associations. And I'm just wondering that these policies a lot of time are impacted, obviously, by the media, and a lot of people support more punitive measures based on what they do see in the media. And I keep noticing that there's so much more of a push in the media, obviously, because of what happened, for these high negative, people brought up anti-Islamic reactions. And I'm wondering what work is being done for the CBE efforts to more, it's almost, I don't want to say like neutralize the media, but almost to put it forward so that the public can, like, I don't know how to word this, but so the public can see that we are trying to work on these preventative measures as opposed to just trying to do the strong-armed approaches, and that you can get more inclusivity by doing that, if that makes any sense. Because if people on the media see, if they're about to be radicalized and they see either the American media that's full of hatred or they see a magazine supporting a terrorist group that's very inclusive, that's like, come join us, we're inclusive, it's going to push that person to go to the inclusive side of the realm. They're not going to go to the side of the realm that's hatred, if that makes any sense. And I'm wondering if these CVE efforts are in trying to incorporate the media in any sort of way, social media and all of that.
Well, CVE relies extensively on social media, but it mostly relies on, again, local voices and non-governmental voices. And with regard to the U.S. press coverage now, I mean, the exact same point was made by an ambassador with whom I was speaking earlier this week, who contrasted the press coverage by one channel in particular with press coverage after terrorist events in Israel, in which there was a very different approach. But we are not and will not be seeking to constrain or otherwise affect press coverage. We are focused on seeking to build support so that this approach can be sustained, and again, try to find the highest and best use of individual actors within this broader whole of society approach. But I would love it if the press would pay more attention to the long-term, less sexy, preventive, behind the scenes, harder to write about, harder to explain, but potentially more important even than some of the short-term stuff. It is perennially a problem in foreign policy in general to build support for things that, if they work by definition, are not explosive and exciting and newsworthy. And so this is something that we do run up against, and it's why, frankly, I'm so grateful to have been invited here to talk to an informed audience, because this is not the kind of effort that gets the big bounce, but it is vitally important, and it is a challenge to build support for this work, even as I am convinced it is every bit as important to our national security to get this rolling in a significant way to scale and with partners and at all levels of that whole of society approach. So I feel very passionately that this is something that the press should pay attention to. I don't know, is Eric Schmidt, did he come? Is he here? He's like the only guy who's come to talk to me really. so it's hard, but right. Thank you for the question.
I'll email him with your remarks. we have time for one more question here before Rob and I each help wrap it up. Can we have the mic right over here, please?
Hi, my name is Laura. It's my understanding that statistically speaking, and based on capability of orchestrating attacks as well as frequency of attacks, right and left wing extremism actually poses the greatest threat to attacks on U.S. soil. So I was wondering how you think, or what you see as the most effective CVE responses to those types of groups?
Well, I think one wants to deal with any violent ideological group in the same way. I mean, CVE principles apply. And, you know, if you talk to people like the Southern Poverty Law Center, they'll probably tell you, although I haven't asked them this, but they probably say, well, that's basically, we've been doing CVE for a long time. So where it's a group and one can trace its activities by following it on the web or by tracking the movement of weapons or by looking at financing sources, that lends itself to a certain degree of analysis and therefore oversight and prevention. What's difficult is that so many of these folks appear to be lone wolves and not always easily linked to the visible networks. And so I think that that's what's interesting to me about the reality in America is that we have not had any Syrian refugees who have proved to be a threat to security. The reality in America is that we do have right-wing groups who are killing more Americans than we have people linked to Islamic-based extremist groups. The reality, getting back to the press question, the reality is sometimes very different from the fears. And that's not to say that the fears aren't justified. It's just that they're not empirically supported by what has occurred. And I think part of what we've been seeking to do through this CVE frame is say, we need to look clear-eyed and long-term at what the real challenges are and how to build a broader coalition of people to address those challenges, because the immediate threats will always be upon us, and we have to be prepared, as the president has committed himself time and time again. My first job is to keep Americans safe. I will never stop focusing on that first. But the idea is to make that job easier over time, not harder. And if you look at the spread of violent extremism on a map or in terms of the level of attacks, that continues to grow. And that's why we need this preventive approach to be a complement to our hard side efforts. But it's still, you are right, that when we actually look at the American experience thus far, the reality of who gets killed and why is very different from people's perceptions of that because of this broader and not unfounded fear. But there is a lot of confusion.
Rob?
I'd like to ask you a question that brings together two pieces of your portfolio. One, CVE, which we've been talking about, and second, mass atrocity, and the potential of that in the Middle East. And this is a question about Christians. First, I want to associate myself with what my colleague Mohammed said earlier about the terrible demagoguery that we've been witnessing in the last number of days about aspects of this issue. And there's been some of that about Christians as well, in an attempt to use the fear of atrocity on Christians as a wedge issue in dealing with this issue. But then there is a reality, too, which is that Christians in the Middle East are uniquely targeted by the Islamic State and other jihadists. And we do have a a status in our laws about giving preferential treatment to religious minorities that are facing unique challenges such as this. So I want to ask you, I guess it's two parts. One, is there a recognition that Christians in the Middle East are that sort of preferential minority that deserves special outreach, special efforts? And then two, how do we balance that? Not balance isn't the right word. How does that fit into our CVE effort and how we explain that to a community that might not recognize the urgency of our outreach to such a preferential minority?
You know, to be honest, I think one of the problems is that Christians aren't uniquely targeted. Christians are targeted, but other groups, other minority groups are targeted too. Gay people are targeted. Yazidis are targeted. And of course, getting back to, again, facts and reality, far more Muslims have been killed than Christians in gross numbers. So I think it's very tricky. It's not to take away the reality that Christians have been persecuted in the current conflict in a way that is breathtaking, but they unfortunately have company. And so I think that, again, we have to be very careful about not allowing our framing of a problem to sometimes just blind us to the complexity of the facts on the ground and the degree to which these particular extremists, you know, ISIL in particular, is deadly and hostile and traumatic for all number of persons, and that is unfortunately why we have to redouble our efforts to address, as the president said, you know, to attack ISIL directly, to stabilize the area, and to find a political solution in Syria, because it is really only through a sustained campaign that we are going to be able to make many who are at risk and are actively targeted by ISIL not live in fear.
Let me ask one last question and bring it back to real current events. On the sidelines of the White House summit, we hosted this event on rehabilitation. I like to break this out from CVE. I like to think about CVE as the strictly preventive and important, but as a separate subset, the kind of de-radicalization portion of it. But we tend to put this all in together, so I'd like to ask the question, and in part because you mentioned the Our House program in passing in your comments, we're going to hear more concerns about some of these rehabilitation programs in light of the attacks in Paris, in part because some of the people who are involved are people who came back returning foreign terrorist fighters. They were interviewed by law enforcement, and they weren't incarcerated. I don't know of any who have been put through the rehab programs, but one of the issues that we keep having discussions about is there a way, like a probation program, to make these somehow mandatory? What do we do about the rehabilitation programs? In other words, it's very hard to prosecute some of these cases if they're not foolish enough to put pictures of themselves doing what they did on social media. Often it's very difficult here in the United States or in Europe to prosecute some of these cases as foreign terrorist fighter returnees, or if they were fighting with groups that aren't designated terrorist groups. And so we have it here, but in Europe, one of the answers has been to develop these rehabilitation programs, but they are not compulsory in any manner. And so it's worth thinking forward about how we or our allies in Europe can deal with this phenomenon of people who are passport holders, who are citizens, who are returning, either haven't broken the law or we can't prove that they broke the law. What type of programming can we think about doing that helps de-radicalize them on one hand, but also does it in such a way that we can have a level of comfort in terms of our safety? Because several of these individuals came home, were interviewed by law enforcement. Law enforcement officer said, I guess this guy doesn't look like he's about to do something right now. And then 6 to 12 months later did. And I've personally interviewed French officials who do this, who are the officials on the front line who are forced to do these interviews, and they're very uncomfortable about it.
Yep. And again, I mean, you raise a really good question, Matt. I think it's a very difficult question. I think many states are currently grappling with it. Nobody has the right formula for it. I think one of the questions we should always ask ourselves in the United States is when we provide advice to our foreign partners about how they should deal with a particular problem, is it a solution that we would be comfortable recommending and adopting at home? And this occurs not just in the case of how do you restrict the freedom of those whom you suspect of having committed criminal acts but cannot prove. It extends also to the questions of speech and whether extremism itself is the problem versus just the incitement to violence or the material support clauses. It exists at a number of levels here. I think that the president's emphasis on seeking to continue to uphold American values so that we can remain true to ourselves while we fight this really horrific generational challenge is where the administration comes to this from. And so I think that we have not moved very far in the domestic debate about how we would address these questions, but I agree with you, it is coming, and I think it will again, as we've talked about in the context of refugees and as the two examples that we've just been talking about, we will be having very difficult conversations about how to balance our traditional American freedoms with the desire for security. And we've seen that the United States sometimes takes a set of actions that it later regrets and reverses. And so I think with the benefit of hindsight, we can have a sober discussion. But I think, and I applaud you for the part that you've done in this regard, it's important to have those conversations prior to a crisis, because we see today how difficult it is to take a longer-term view when there is a crisis. And so it probably would behoove us to move toward a more fulsome public discussion at home, even as we think about how to counsel our partners abroad about how to make these difficult choices.
Well, I want to thank you for contributing to that discussion. This has been a fantastic event. For those of you who really follow these issues and listen to people who are speaking about them, you know that this was a unique conversation, very forthright, and just cutting to the very core of the issues. I want to thank you for taking the time and for sharing your thoughts with us. Please join me in thanking the Undersecretary, and thank you all for taking the time as well.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Thank you very much.